Now, when talking about network latency, it's the time to cross the network in one direction. When talking about latency, most developers are familiar with a concept called round-trip time. Round-trip time is, for example, when looking at a client talking to a server, is that we'd measure the time that it takes from the invocation until we get a response. The reason why we don't focus on round-trip time when talking about distributed systems is because it intermingles things like serialization and deserialization, which really have nothing to do with the network, and the actual processing time on the server. So when we're looking here specifically at latency, we're looking at, given that we've serialized everything and we're ready to go to the network, how long does it actually take to get from the client to the server? So the thing is, and in that coding model, we kind of assume it's effectively zero. And usually when we run things on our own machine, it really is effectively zero. But the thing is that as you're building a more geographically distributed system, whether it's starting from a LAN environment and then crossing to a wide area network or the internet at large, you end up increasing orders of magnitude at each step in terms of how slow it goes. So just to give you a sense of what those order of magnitudes are, and you have this printed up in front of you, there's this nice table that fellow speaker created that normalized all sorts of computing operations to the time of one CPU cycle, where one CPU cycle was scaled to being 1 second. Why? Because as human beings, we're not really wired to understand the difference between nanosecond, microsecond, and millisecond. We hear all of those things, we just hear second, 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 and it's like, yeah, it's pretty fast, even though there are 6 order of magnitudes difference between them. So with CPUs that are doing roughly 3 billion operations per second, if one CPU cycle is 1 second, accessing main memory from the CPU is 6 minutes, right? 1 second, you find something in memory, that's 6 minutes, all right? Give you a sense of the kind of difference that we're talking about. You need to go from memory to disk, you're jumping from 6 minutes to potentially 6 days, all right? Not minutes to hours, minutes to days. It is that much slower just accessing a drive on the same machine when scaled with 1 second equals one CPU cycle. You want to start going outside of your machine to the big bad internet, things get a whole lot worse, a whole lot faster. So you want to cross the internet, let's say from coast to coast in the continental United States, San Francisco to New York. The actual number is roughly 40 milliseconds. When you scale that, that works out to roughly 4 years if one CPU cycle is 1 second, right? So one remote call, continental US, 4 years compared to the 1 second CPU operation, all right? Just to go back, this, newing up an object, is on the order of seconds. This, making a remote call to something else, years. And that's what's so dangerous about our programming models, that you have developers that talk on and on about ways in which they can improve the performance of their system. The number one issue is that two lines of code sitting side by side can have this difference of seconds and years in terms of a performance characteristic. And it becomes that much harder when we use modern day programming techniques like dependency injection. Who uses dependency injection, by the way? Great, you all should. It's a great technique. Don't get me wrong, it improves the testability of our code and decouples things. All of that's great. But the thing that it does is it hides this line of code, right? You just declare a dependency on an iSomething service. And you don't know when you invoke a method on the iSomething service whether that's going to be a local call or a remote call, right? So in essence, we create this model where as we're programming, the performance at runtime is better and better hidden. And then we start deploying things to production and users start playing with the system and they say, the system is slow. And now we're kind of stuck. It's okay, where exactly is the system slow? What is the culprit? And we've done such a good job at hiding from ourselves where all of these remote invocations are that it becomes that much harder to find it.
Hi, I'm Udi Dahan. I hope you're enjoying these clips on the fallacies of distributed computing. Click on the left to watch the next video, or on the right to go to the fallacies playlist, or in the middle to subscribe to our channel. For more information, including the full videos from my course, check out the links below the video. Thanks, and see you next time.